Hello everyone and welcome to the second part of the imperix ACG SDK Getting Started Guide. This video will be dedicated to the simulation of the buck converter and its control that we've put in place in the previous video. So if you haven't seen the first part yet, you may want to watch it first. So, let's start from where we left off. In this and every other model implemented with the ACG SDK, the simulation models the physical quantities, such as the converter currents, voltages or PWM signals applied to the switch, and the controller's behavior. The idea is to test the controller's behavior in its environment in an offline simulation before switching to real power with a real converter prototype. To model everything accurately, a distinction is made between the physical quantities, the inputs and outputs of the plant model, which are modeled with continuous or semi-continuous signals, and on the other side, the controller variables, which are discrete signals, computed at each control period of the controller. This reflects the sampling and the execution of the control algorithm within an interrupt routine executed at a fixed rate. So the model here will have different execution rates, the continuous signals and the discrete signals. The interfaces between the two worlds are the imperix library blocks, which represent the physical interface of the imperix controllers. With the ACG SDK library, the execution rates are automatically defined in the whole model, according to the interrupt parameters in the configuration block. So there is no need to define them by hand. However, it is always good practice to check that everything has been interpreted correctly before running the simulation. To display the timing legend in Simulink, it is sufficient to right-click with the mouse and select Sample Time Display, Colors. From there, it can be seen that the physical signals highlighted in black are continuous, whereas the control algorithm in red is discrete. The red sample time corresponds to the execution rate of the main interrupt, previously set to 20 kHz, with an added phase shift to represent the default sampling phase of 0.5. Before running the simulation, let's add a few scopes to display the simulation results. What we want to display here is the measured output voltage, along with its reference value to verify the reference tracking ability of the control and the measured output current to illustrate the effect of the sampling phase. In addition to the sampled value, the current measurement at the plant output can be directly scoped to display the output current ripples. This is somewhat equivalent to connecting a current probe to the converter's output and displaying its measurement on an oscilloscope. The data type conversion block is used to make sure that the data type of the muxed signals match. Finally, the simulation time is reduced to 100 milliseconds to simulate only the desired time window. Let's now simulate by clicking the Run button or Control T. Let's now have a look at the simulation results. If we look at the output voltage in yellow, we can see that overall, it follows the desired value in blue. The first two perturbations come from a step in the input voltage at 25 milliseconds and the load step at 50 milliseconds and are rejected by the control. This graph also shows the tracking performance for the voltage reference step at 75 milliseconds. The measured voltage in steady state is not exactly 12 volts because of the plant output voltage, which is not perfectly flat due to the switching of the transistor. So, depending on when the measured value is sampled, this can lead to a slight steady state error, which is not compensated in this simple feedforward control. Let's now have a look at the output current of the converter. On the bottom graph, the output current ripples are displayed in blue, as if measured by a current probe, whereas the sampled value is in yellow. The blue signal is sampled on the rising edges of the sampling clock displayed in the top scope. As expected, with a sampling phase of 0.5, and a triangular carrier with a phase of zero, the current ripple is always sampled at its middle, even during transients. This gives direct access to the average value of the ripples, without any oversampling or extra computations. In short, with a sampling phase of 0.5 and a triangular carrier with a phase of zero, this ensures that the sampling never occurs at the same time as the duty cycle is updated, namely the zero of the carrier, and this produces PWM pulses that are always centered around the sampling instance. These concepts are accurately modeled by the simulation blocks of the ACG SDK library and can thus be verified in simulation. It is clear that if the sampling phase is changed to, for instance, 0.2, the sampling will not occur in the middle of the current ripple, and the sample current will no longer represent the average of the current ripples. Similarly, if we switch to another carrier shape, the ripple will no longer be sampled in the middle. For instance, the bottom of the ripple is sampled while using a sawtooth carrier and a sampling phase of 0. Although this may be a nice feature of sawtooth carriers, this has the clear disadvantage that the sampling is always done exactly on the switching edges, which can cause severe perturbations on the measured value. In contrast, sampling in the middle of the switching period ensures that the sampling occurs far enough from the switching edges, and that, at that time, the induced perturbations are damped. To sum up, thanks to the simulation, we verified that our control algorithm works as expected and understood the effect of various parameters. In the next video, we are going to see how to generate code from the same Simulink model and how to execute it on an imperix controller.